Now that we've looked at how to do hypothesis tests when we have two means that we're comparing, we looked at independent relationships and how we put those into two lists and evaluate them using the function on our calculator, which is the two mean t-test. We're now going to look at an alternative way that we can evaluate whether there's significant difference between two means, but we're doing this for relationships that are dependent. So in this section, we're going to explore another method for testing relationships between two variables. Again, when the explanatory variable is categorical and the response variable is quantitative. In this section, however, our two variables will be dependent. And if you can remember back to the picture that we looked at previously, when we were talking about independent samples, there were completely two different samples that really were separate, had no relationship with each other, except for some defining difference between the two, whether we had males over here and females over here, or having not had two beers and had two beers. But in an independent situation, we're dealing with two different sets of people or things. In a dependent situation, we still have that division between the two populations. However, we're actually dealing with the same group for the most part, or they have some sort of connection that makes them pair up with each other. This is a matched pairs situation. And this is what we have when we have two samples that are dependent. So still some defining characteristics that separate them. We get two different measurements, but from the same people, or possibly people with the same genetic makeup, like identical twins. So the reaction times, measured in seconds in an obstacle course, are measured for 8 randomly selected drivers before and then after the consumption of 2 beers. So here's the same group of people, but the qualifications that we have broken them down into, this is before 2 beers and after 2 beers, that's a categorical difference between the two, but they still represent the same group of people. This is a situation where we can use the methods that we're going to talk about today. So same group of randomly selected individuals, reaction times taken before and after. So, in a matched pairs experiment, the size of the two samples are naturally the same size, because we're talking about the same group of people, and each X is naturally paired with a response Y. This being the case, we can set it up so that we are testing the outcome of a single mean, which we will call the mean of the differences. In other words, we take our two groups, and we take the matched pairs that we have in our samples, and we create a third group, which is the difference between these. So we take the mean of the difference in both reaction time, in total reaction time, before 2 beers and then after 2 beers. Literally, we're subtracting them. That's, you know, what a difference is. And then we take that set of data, and we perform all of our stuff on that one variable, which is the differences between the means. And then we're going to use a simple t-test using our calculators. So now, because we have reduced our data from two lists, two matched pairs of data, to one list of just individual differences, our hypotheses will differ a little bit from the previous section. In other words, we've taken two sets of data and we've narrowed it down to a single set of data, which is the difference of the two numbers. So the null hypothesis is always that there will be no difference between them. And so if two groups were identical, in other words, the reaction times did not change whatsoever, their differences would be zero. And so that's going to be our assumption. We're going to assume that there aren't any differences unless we can prove significant differences statistically. Then, of course, our alternative is going to go in one direction or two directions, depending on the wording of the question from the beginning. and what we believe is going to happen. For example, in the previous problem, we may say that the reaction times are going to increase. So the first set of data, the sober drivers, they're going to have a smaller reaction time than the other set of data. And so we would expect to see something going in a negative direction. And so their differences would be negative. This represents negative numbers, right? Which would mean the first set had a smaller group of numbers than the second set, being that it would probably take somebody more time to react after they've had two beers. All right, so at this point, I want to want you to pull out your calculators, and we're going to go through this together. And I'm going to see if I can get this in the screen so you can see it, and also pull my calculator in here at the same time. You can see at this point that I already have these values in my calculator. So if you're watching this and you have your calculator ready, you should be at this point pausing the video so you can input the first group into list one. So this is a study investigated the difference in volume of the right hippocampus in 15 pairs of identical twins. Again, identical twins had the same genetic makeup, so we would expect there to be differences. Or we would expect there to not be any differences because they have the same genetic makeup. However, one twin was affected by schizophrenia where the other was not. Test with a significance level of 0.05. So we're going to put these into list one, these into list two. And then we're also going to take note that we're doing a two-tail test here, which would say they're not equal versus there is no difference between them. Okay, so pause the video, put these into list one and list two. Remember, you do that by going to stat and then edit. And if you have things in your list already, highlight L3 and hit clear and then enter. And that'll highlight whatever list you're wanting to erase. Pause the video and do that. All right, now that you have the values in your lists, we're going to make a third list. I'm going to go up and highlight. Notice I'm highlighting L3 there. And I'm going to give L3 a formula, L1 minus L2. So I'm going to go second 1 and then minus second 2 to put in list 1 minus list 2. Then I hit enter and it fills out the list with all of my values. These values being the differences between the two different brain weights. All right. Now, once you've done that, now we're ready to run our actual test. We can see here, just looking at these numbers, that the first list does appear to be slightly larger than the second list of numbers. But we don't know if that's a significant difference, and so we want to use the t-curve to try to see where this would land on the t-curve and what its p-value would be. So we're going to go to stat again, and I'm going to go to tests. And yes, we are dealing with three sets of numbers here, but we're only going to focus on the third set, which I had in list three. So as I go down to choice number two, we're not doing the two sample t-test as we were before, choice number four. We're actually doing a one sample t-test because we're just going to take into consideration list three. All right. Now, there's two different ways you can do this. If you highlight stats and hit enter, what this is going to do is it's going to allow you to fill in the mean, which in this case would be 0, and then what the average was, standard deviation, etc. But if you simply just go to data and hit enter, and then tell it you want to pull from list 3, which is the list we just did, or if you have a different list. Also, you want to put not equal to as your alternative hypothesis, and then we want to hit calculate. So as I go down, and here we have our list of values for the t-test. The first value is my test statistic value, 2.984, and then my p-value is 0.009, and that would round to a 9. The mean difference was 0.15, and then the standard deviation of the sample was 0.19. And then there were 15 values in my lists. Great. So this gives us some information to go on. Going back to our slide presentation here, now we just need to interpret this. As we run this analysis, we see the mean is 0.15 and it's 15, and our standard deviation was 0.95. So you could have inputted those directly into, when you go into your t-test, put those numbers in, or if you already have a list of values in your calculator, you can just go to data and have it pull it automatically. So with our test statistic of 2.98, which is a p-value of 0.0099, we would compare this to the significance level of the test, which the significance level of the test is 0.05. Being that 0.0099, my p-value is less than 0.05, that suggests we want to reject the null hypothesis. We have just shown that there is sufficient evidence to suggest that there is a significant change in the hippocampus at the 0.05 level of significance. For this p-value, this is the area in both tails. I want to point that out because it was a two-tailed test, but when your p-value is pulled up, it's already doubling whatever that area was to the right of 2.98. So you never have to worry about in the t-test whether you have to double it or not. Whatever the p-value comes up as, that is a number that has already been doubled if it needed to be. And that is the end of this presentation for measuring the difference between two means for dependent samples.